It's been more than a year since I covered Sons of the Forest during its early access phase. However, back in February, the game officially left early access and launched its version 1.0. And visually speaking, everything I said in my last video is still applies here in this new version. The game takes full advantage of Unity's engine high definition render pipeline, or HDRP, to deliver beautiful and stunning visuals, particularly the foliage and the environmental details. But it still has some issues like the subpar rain effect and low resolution volumetrics, and the spike in the CPU usage that I pointed out on my previous video still persists in this new version. However, they appear to occur less frequently compared to the early access version. And when it comes to the graphics settings, both versions are pretty much similar. The only difference is the addition of a new setting for anisotropic filtering and new names for some options. So in this video, we will retest each and every graphics setting to determine the optimal balance between good performance and visuals. So without any further ado, let's get going. Let's kick off by comparing the early access version and the newest one. And here we can see some disparities. The most notable one is the lower VRAM usage with the new version. And in terms of performance, we can see on average around 4% difference between the two versions, which is not that significant. However, it seems like the current version has more consistent performance and stability, as indicated by the percentile lows. And if we move on to image quality, we can see that the game now supports FSR3, unlike the old version which only had FSR1. And if we compare FSR3, DLSS and TAA, we can see that the game's TAA still has a lot of issues, with noticeable shimmering and aliasing, especially on foliage and trees. And both DLSS and FSR3, despite their lower internal resolution, provide much better image quality. But as expected, DLSS still looks better and more stable compared to FSR3. The game also supports dynamic resolution scaling, which can work, but it's limited to use only with FSR1 and TAA, and this can significantly impact the image quality. So for this one, I recommend using DLSS or FSR3 instead of dynamic resolution or TAA. And if you don't like temporal anti-aliasing, there is an option to use FXAA, SMAA or no AA at all. And here you can see the performance and visual difference between these options and TAA. Let's move on to the graphics section, starting with draw distance. And as you know, this one controls the amount of objects rendered at a distance. And as a result, lower options would lead to some noticeable popping close to the camera. And performance-wise, particularly when CPU bound, we can see that the options from ultra low to high perform almost similarly, with ultra costing a little bit more. So for this one, I recommend medium or high, especially if you have a weaker CPU. Next, we have ambient occlusion, and it seems like this setting is broken because I couldn't notice any visual or performance difference when switching between off and ultra, as ambient occlusion is always enabled regardless of the options. And it's worth noting that during early access, this setting worked as intended, and as you can see here, there is no significant performance difference when going from off to ultra. So here I recommend keeping this one at ultra. Fog quality is next, and as I mentioned during the intro, volumetric effects are one of the visual weaknesses of this game. And as you can see here, even the high option at native 1440p displays low resolution volumetrics. And performance wise, going from off to low costs around 3%, and to high 7%. So here I recommend keeping this one disabled, but if you want to enable it, make sure to keep it at low. Now regarding texture filtering, we have two settings. First, the old anisotropic textures alongside a new setting called terrain anisotropic textures, which gives more control over texture filtering with two options, low and high. Unlike the old setting that only have a toggle with off or on. And here we can see that pushing this setting to high improves the clarity of textures without any significant performance impact. So here I recommend keeping anisotropic textures enabled with terrain anisotropic textures set to high. Moving on to shadow quality, and here we can see that medium, high and ultra offer more defined and acceptable shadows unlike ultra low and low. And on the performance side, going from ultra low to medium costs around 5%, to high 8% and to ultra 11%. So for this one, I recommend sticking with medium or high shadows. Next we have clouds, and similar to the early access version, going from low to high enables volumetric clouds that can partially block out the sun and cast shadows into the landscape, which dynamically alters the game's lighting intensity. And performance wise, going from low to high costs around 10%. So here I recommend low, but if you have enough performance to spare, use high. Grass is next, and here we can see that this one adjusts the density and render distance of ground foliage, and performance wise at this scene, going from low to medium has a small impact around 2%, and going to high costs around 7%. So here I recommend medium or high. Moving on to water, and as you can see here, this one controls the quality of water surfaces and simulation effects. And performance wise, I couldn't notice any significant difference between low and high in many scenes and many scenarios. That's why I recommend keeping this one at high. Next we have parallax distance. This one controls parallax occlusion mapping, which gives more depth to flat surfaces like here. And performance wise, this setting has negligible impact. So here I recommend high parallax distance. Moving on to billboard quality, in Sons of the Forest, distant objects and especially trees and foliage are made of typical 3D meshes in addition to simpler and 2D billboards, and this setting adjusts the draw distance of these billboards. Like here, we can see that both low and medium display fewer bushes and grass at a distance compared to high. And if I move forward, we can see more pop-in with low and medium, because the billboards here serve as a fallback for these 3D meshes, which can help hide the LOD pop-in. And performance wise at this scene, with a lot of trees on screen, we can see that going from low to medium costs around 4% and to high 6%. So here I recommend keeping this one at high, but if LOD pop-in doesn't bother you, use low instead and save the extra performance. And the last setting in this section is texture resolution, and this one is straightforward as it controls the quality and resolution of textures, as you can see here. And VRAM wise, the game is not that demanding, and from what I have seen, the used VRAM is always around 5 GB, even at native 1440p with ultra textures. Now let's move on to some additional settings in the features section, starting with screen space reflections. Here at this scene, we can see that disabling SSR can significantly compromise the game's visuals and the look of water surfaces. And performance-wise, SSR costs around 6%. So here I recommend keeping it enabled. Next we have micro shadowing and contact shadows, and both serve similar purposes in capturing small details and objects, with contact shadows focusing on small foliage as you can see here, and micro shadowing on micro details like these tree cracks. And performance wise we can see that contact shadows can cost around 5%, while micro shadowing has no significant performance impact. So here I'll maintain the same recommendation as in my previous video, and I suggest keeping both of them enabled if you can, but if you need the extra performance, disable contact shadows and keep micro shadowing enabled, and don't disable them both, as doing so will significantly compromise the game's visuals. And with all that being said, these are my recommended settings for Sons of the Forest. Let's now quickly compare the performance of optimized settings and ultra preset at native 1440p with TAA. And here we can see on average around 25% performance increase with minimal visual impact when going from ultra preset to optimized settings. Now 25% increase may not sound significant, but I don't recommend lowering the settings further. Instead, take advantage of DLSS or FSR3, because as I mentioned earlier in the video, they offer significant better image quality compared to native TAA. And with that, we arrive at the end of this video. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos. And hopefully, I'll see you all in the next one.